It's pretty much like being kicked off a cliff in a washing machine.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of the My Defining Moments podcast. I'm Chris, and today I'm joined by an Olympian who is one of only five people to win medals at both the Summer and Winter Olympic Games. Lauryn Williams is a world and Olympic champion, sprinting her way to 100-meter gold in 2005 before swapping the athletics track for the bobsleigh track. A silver medal at Sochi saw Lauryn become the first American woman to stand on an Olympic podium at both the Summer and Winter Games. In a career surrounded by fine margins and performing on the big stage, let's waste no more time and discover the moments that defined Lauryn Williams. Okay, hi Lauryn, thanks for joining me. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful, Chris. Thank you so much for having me on the show.
No, it's great. Thanks. Yeah, thanks for being here. So obviously this is five defining moments. So we're going to find out what your five moments are as we chat. But just want to start by asking you, like, what are you doing at the moment? What's keeping you busy in 2020?
All sorts of things. 2020 has been a very busy year. Currently at the moment, I'm doing lots of speaking engagements. That's actually where I'm headed when I'm done chatting with you. Also running a financial planning company. So I help young professionals organize their finances. And so just working within my regular company, but also doing speaking engagements for a lot of athletic organizations. So recently I actually spoke to the British athletes as well and talked about money mindset. And that was a pretty cool opportunity. Worldwide, nationwide, all over the place, speaking. And like I said, trying to make sure that people have the most organized finances and people are telling their money stories as much as possible.
And that, are you specifically focusing on athletes then? Is that your kind of remit?
Athletes and young professionals. So when I say young professionals, I see people kind of in their 20s and 30s that are kind of starting out, trying to understand money better, never made a budget before, you know, maybe have some debt they need to get rid of before they start, you know, saving aggressively. You know, kind of at the beginning of things, you want to get married, but you don't know, you know, you manage your finances alone and then the other person did as well. And now you're trying to figure out how to do it together. More of those kind of like basic starter sort of financial topics are where I specialize. In America, student loans are a pretty big deal. So I actually have a special expertise for that as well. So those are the kind of things I'm helping people with.
I guess it's something that's not really covered at school that much either. So it's quite important, especially when you're young to learn that stuff. So I guess going back to your early life, how and when did sport kind of make an appearance in your life?
Yeah, so it's a funny story that my mom will say, I got home faster than the family German Shepherd, and that's where it all got started for me. My dad, on the other hand, always tells a story about me being at the Carnegie Science Center and racing a Flojo hologram. So there was this like kind of hologram. I couldn't have been set at world record pace because I was like 10 or 11 years old. And he said I just stayed there all day. I was pretty obsessed with it. I was like the youngest kid to beat the hologram. And so it was a pretty big deal. And that's when he knew that I was going to have some, you know, special abilities as it pertains to track and field.
And then I guess through school you did track. And when did you realize that this was going to be like a career for you?
I didn't really understand that it could be a career until it became a career. So, you know, for me, it became an avenue to, you know, other things that I wanted to have in my life. And so that, you know, first thing was going to university. So I attended the University of Miami, and that was a pretty big deal to get a college education for free. So going from, you know, am I going to be able to go to college? I come from a family with five sisters, two brothers. So a lot of people to feed, not a lot of money to go around. My dad actually was diagnosed with leukemia and was unable to work for, you know, much of my kind of teenage years. And so it was just kind of like limited funds that needed to cover all these other things. And there wasn't enough to save for college and things. So I learned about academic scholarships and was trying to keep my grades really high. And then I was like learning about that there was track and field, you know, there were sports scholarships, and I got these letters in the mail, and I was like, oh, this could be an avenue for me to be able to go to school. Like, I'm much more interested in running around this circle now. So that was kind of like a big thing for me to kind of get to the University of Miami and, you know, be able to take advantage of the free education. And I felt very grateful for that opportunity.
And that is the first defining moment you've given me of your five is going to the University of Miami. Was that a choice? Did you get a choice in which university you went to, or was that the one you were kind of pushed towards?
Yeah, I was lucky in the fact that I did get a choice. So I was recruited by multiple schools. I was not recruited by all the big schools. So there's, you know, kind of at the time, some schools that were, you know, the creme de la creme. And I didn't get offers from very many of those, but there were very, you know, still quite a few Division I schools. And ultimately, I chose the University of Miami because the weather is beautiful. It was far enough away from home that, you know, they were going to have to get on a plane to come see me, or I was going to have to get on a plane and go back. So I was very much looking to create some separation so that I could just, you know, come into my own and really get a good understanding of who I was and, you know, kind of just become that adult that I wanted to. And I don't regret that decision at all. I think it was a huge moment in my life because, you know, it was a place where I turned the corner and said, you know, I'm no longer, you know, a child in the sense I was 17 actually when I went to college. So I was still actually not even of legal age at that point. Turned 18 on 9/11, which that was the 9/11 that I turned 18 years old. And so it went from like, oh my goodness, I want to get away from home to, oh my goodness, I want my mommy. Like, but it was a really, really defining moment in my life because it changed the trajectory for the way things would play out forever. You know, from a track and field perspective, from an education perspective, the people that I met, the different cultures that I came across. Miami's a melting pot. I was living in small town Pennsylvania where there's very little diversity. So it was just a whole new world. And I think it really, really helped shape who I am.
And then I guess with track being your career then, it was kind of took you around the world a little bit. I mean, you went to the World Juniors in 2002 in Jamaica, which looking back is kind of seen as one of the best editions of it because so many people came from those champs. And what was that like?
I did. I got to experience some really cool, rare moments where, you know, tons of Olympians that had really long careers were able to participate in the 2002 games. And it was just so much fun to be on that team, to get to know those people and, you know, be leaving the country for the first time, kind of like you said, without parents. So we went to Bahamas prior to going to Jamaica for like a little small meet. I had to get my passport and, you know, it was a really big deal to be like, oh, okay, like you've made it to a point where you get to go and you see the world and that there's different cultures and there's different things to eat. And, you know, being of Caribbean descent, I was aware of Bahamas and Jamaica. My father is Trinidadian, but, you know, getting over there and just like, wow, like this is a really cool opportunity. And then to look back on it and say like, wow, that was a super cool opportunity. Like look at all the people that came out of that was really neat.
And then I guess it wasn't too long before you were making national squads and going to the World Champs in 2003. You were in Paris. What was that like making your first team?
It was interesting. Paris was very interesting because I made the team after winning the Pan Am game. So I won Pan Ams, which was technically the first team that I made. But because I did well there, they decided to bring me over to Paris for the World Championships as an alternate for the relay. And so it was an honor and a privilege, but also it was kind of the first markings, you know, from that 2002 team that, you know, many of us kind of were a part of what we call the changing of the guard. But it was one of the first markings of that. And so there were quite a few young athletes that were on that 2002 team that also made a 2003 team. And off the top of my head, I think of Bershawn Jackson and Allison Felix, who, you know, went on and, you know, competed in multiple Olympics with me. But we weren't like the most well-received over there because there's tons of professional athletes that are well into their career. They're adults. They're doing this for a living. And, you know, here comes this college, you know, sophomore that is, you know, wanting to participate and has run fast enough to, you know, have earned a spot. So it was nice, but it was also a little bit intimidating. And, you know, he said, this was what they did for a living. This is what I did to get my free education sort of deal. And I didn't want to do anything that was going to mess up the way that they could earn their living. So it was a lot of pressure to participate in the 2003 games in Paris.
Did it, you said you mentioned that it was a bit like a changing of the guard. Did it feel like that for you guys? Did you feel like there was this great generation of American athletes that were coming through? You're all the same age and you're all making the same teams. Did it feel like a moment?
It didn't yet. You know, like I said, looking back on it, I can see like, oh yeah, 2002, like you said, the number of people who had great and long careers. 2003, you know, a few of us burst on the scene. I think 2004 was when it was like, we came in kicking the door down and a lot of people got displaced, and that was the true changing of the guard. And we knew it, we felt it, and we also took ownership of it.
Well, yeah, you mentioned 2004, obviously Olympic year. You made the team, Olympic debut. I mean, what is it like going to your first Olympics?
My first Olympics was pretty cool. The thing that stands out to me about the first Olympic Games was kind of like just feeling all this pressure of, oh my goodness, how did I get here? Because the year went into fast forward mode. All that year prior, you know, leading up to the Games, I was planning on winning the national championships for college. So that was the simple goal that I had, as I want to be an NCAA champion. You know, what do I need to do? What do I need to change in order to do that? My goal was not at all the Olympic Games. I was, you know, aware that it was the Olympic year, but like, I didn't even feel that that was in reach. You know, I hadn't won the national championships in college. So it's like, I got to beat all the college girls and go beat some professionals. Like, yeah, no, I'm just going to try to win the college nationals. And I think in pursuit of that, you know, sometimes we're setting ourselves up and we don't even realize it for something much greater than what it is that we're trying to achieve. So I won the college national championships. And at that time, it was the second fastest time in the world and the first fastest time by an American that year. So immediately people's focus turned to, oh my goodness, she's the favorite to win the Olympic trials. And, you know, I had to start making these decisions really quick. Sponsors started coming out, agents started coming out, and, you know, I had to kind of figure out how to navigate all that.
And then obviously you find yourself in the team and you're in Athens. And what was it like being in Athens, you know, the home of the Olympics for your first games?
Yeah, I couldn't have planned it better, even though I didn't plan it at all. Really cool opportunity to go to the birthplace of the games and to be able to see where it all started and to, you know, for it to have all started for me in the same place that the game started for everyone.
And then obviously your individual performance, you know, silver medal in the 100 meters in your first games. That's a pretty solid achievement.
Yeah, I was really excited. Like I said, you know, usually we focus on the fact that we didn't win. And I think later on in life, I felt a little bit more, you know, kind of less excited that I didn't win. But in that moment, in those first few years, it was like, this is the most awesome thing ever. Like, I'm the second fastest in the whole world in the premier event. And then to go on the following year and to win the world championships was like, wow, like what a cool opportunity to be able to call myself the fastest woman in the world.
And just going back to that Olympic final, you set a personal best, you know, fastest time ever. Do you look back on that medal and think, actually, maybe it was a goal looking at
yes,
the person
yes.
who won?
Right. I tried to say it nicely, but since you're going to bring it up, yes, that is why later down the road, I'm not as excited about a silver medal, because I'm pretty close to positive that it was. And, you know, the kind of turning point for me was a colleague of mine, Adam Nelson, earned a gold medal. He earned a silver in 2004 as well. And they went back and they did some additional testing and they found out that the gold medalist, which is also from the same country as the gold medalist from my event, you know, had tested positive. And that kind of gave enough weight to me. And it was just, you know, there were some things that were fishy to begin with, but I was just kind of like, I'll roll with it. Once that came out, I felt like, you know, that would have been the opportunity for them to also test that and to go back. But there's a 10-year statute of limitations and they were running right up on it. And we, you know, missed the opportunity to kind of ask for an inquiry or, you know, get something done that could have also led to me being a gold medalist in 2004.
Yeah, I think, well, speaking from as a fan point of view, we kind of knew at the time, we were like, who is this person who's come out of nowhere running sub 11 in every round? And I think, yeah, I think rest assured that we know who's the gold medalist from that race.
Yeah.
And then also, yeah, you also competed in the relay and didn't quite go to plan. Was that what happened in that race?
Yeah. I still don't know what happened. I haven't watched any replays of it to say, you know, exactly. We didn't get the stick around, though. That's the kind of final thing, is that some mistakes were made. And I feel like in both 2004 and 2008, if I had to kind of attribute, you know, blame to something, it would be that we didn't have good camaraderie behind the scenes. So, you know, there was an actual event that caused the, you know, baton to be dropped on the track. But I think that all the energy leading up to that event was the actual thing that caused fault. So it's not really one person or the other, but it was the negative energy that we had because we weren't handled well behind the scenes.
But then, like you say, the next year it was a different story in the individual event. Your world championships in Helsinki, terrible cold conditions, but you came away with a gold medal in a great time, and well, a decent time, and it was pretty close. Did you think you'd won when you crossed the line?
I had no idea what happened in 2005. You know, I just kind of like run for my life, and you know, I look up and I'm like, yay, this is awesome. Like, you go kind of in this tunnel vision whenever you're like really, you know, things are going the way you want them to go. And so you literally don't know what's happened until well after you cross the line, if you're like really running at your best. So I have very little awareness of those that are next to me or the crowd or anything. Like, anytime I have awareness, I'm not going fast enough. So yeah, it was a very pleasant surprise. I mean, I knew I was in great shape. I had trained for it. I had, you know, planned to win, you know, but yeah, I was still shocked and amazed at the result.
And was it a proud moment standing on the rostrum listening to the American national anthem as you got your gold medal?
Oh yeah, that was definitely a very proud moment. You know, I had really great career, but not very many times did I get to stand on the top of the podium. As a matter of fact, I think, you know, that 2005 was the two times that I did get to do it.
Yeah, when you mentioned, yeah, another gold in the relay, and then the following year, indoor silver at the World Indoors in a dead heat. I mean, close finishes seem to be a theme throughout your career.
Very much so. Yeah, that was the beginning of lots of contentious finishes for me, but always on the podium. So, you know, I try to look back on it and, like you said, just kind of remind myself I was one of the best during my time period.
And then, well, bringing us on to your second defining moment, which was in 2006, you said going to Africa for the first time. Why was that so special for you?
Yeah, so I think a lot of people don't realize that, you know, when you're in track and field, you are in, you know, there's various events and there's various ways to earn money, and that there are what we call the premier events. So, you know, I was very fortunate to be in a premier event. Like I said, I didn't plan that. I didn't, you know, grow up wanting to be a track athlete because they made the most money, or being a 100-meter runner because they made the most. But I was really fortunate, and I had seen more money at that point than I felt like most of my family members had ever seen in life. You know, in 2004, 2005, after, you know, doing well. And in 2006, an organization asked me to go with them to Africa. It's called Right to Play. It's still an organization. Actually, I think they're British based as well. And I didn't know what I was getting into. I was like, oh yeah, this sounds fun. I'm going to go and I'm going to, you know, do some volunteer work, and I'm going to go to a new country. I'm going to go to Africa. Yay. But you got over there and you realize just how different various parts of the world are, how blessed we are in America, you know, to have the things that we do. And, you know, that even those that are suffering and are impoverished and are in, you know, tough scenarios here, are not, you know, it's not similar. It's not the same as what some other countries are experiencing. And the thing that stuck out to me was how little people had, but how much joy they had, despite how little they had. For me, the kind of part of the story and the thing that, like, was, you know, mind blowing and, you know, a real change of perception for me was I had just purchased the home right before I went over to this trip. And, you know, it was a 4-bedroom home, 4-bathroom, swimming pool. And I was one person. I wasn't married. I didn't have any kids. Like, it was, you know, it was a bit much. And when I tell you that the size of the things that people were living in Africa were, you know, the size of, you know, my smallest bathroom, and multiple people were living in it, it was just a game changer to see, like I said, this idea that, you know, wealth and money and material things are not the thing that is going to make you happy. And we say that a lot, but I got to visually see people that, you know, were just joyful in their heart and happy to, you know, just be out. And they needed very little in order to really love their life, and love being around. And it just made me kind of make a hard course correction about not being wasteful, being, you know, honoring the funds that I did receive and being more strategic about, you know, what I need versus what I want, and then how I can help others because I, you know, have been blessed enough to, you know, to earn more than what I need. So just to be very mindful of not letting my lifestyle grow as my income grew, and realizing that, you know, There is an amount that everyone needs to be able to get by, but above and beyond that, you need to be very, you know, strategic about how you are able to make an impact in the lives of others.
And do you think that's impacted with the work that you're doing now?
Oh, for sure. You know, it was, like I said, the first kind of time that I realized, like, you know, your finances matter. And I wasn't frivolous, like, you know, these things, like, I didn't... Well, the house wasn't actually a good decision. That's a whole nother story. But, you know, it wasn't that I was like, you know, throwing dollars out the window, or, you know, we hear some of these crazy athlete stories of Ferraris and making it rain and, you know, just literally throwing money away. I wasn't a frivolous person, but I also didn't have a very clear sense of a line of my spending being aligned with my values. And that's a lot of what I talk to my clients about presently, is does your spending align with what your values are? If not, then we need to realign your spending, so that it's reflective of who you want to be and who you want to be seen as. And so it definitely laid the groundwork for, you know, where I am and how I'm organizing my finances now and how I'm helping other people organize their finances.
That's good. And then just, well, going back to your track life, after 2006, 2007, it was another World Championships and probably one of the closest finishes ever in 100 meter sprints. It was just 100 separating all the medalists, and it was a dead heat between you and Veronica Campbell-Brown for the gold. Did it flash up on the scoreboard that you actually won? What actually happened?
Yeah, it flashed on the scoreboard that like 5 or 6 different people won, so... It was, you know, I think everybody in the race won at some point, which was super confusing, because it wasn't that close between the others, but they definitely didn't get it right initially and they were trying to figure it out. And, you know, the thing that's most frustrating for me for that race, like, I respect Veronica Campbell a lot. You know, she was my main competitor for most of my career. And I think she challenged me to be a better athlete. You know, every time I knew I was going to step on the line, I knew she was going to be ready, so I better be ready. But the challenging thing was 2008, they also declared a tie, and they declared the tie in like 2 seconds. You know, two people cross the line. They're like, oh, we can't decipher between the difference. Here's 2 silver medals. And it's like, it took them over an hour to decide what, you know, who won the race between Veronica and I. And in that regard, I felt like 2 gold medals could have just been given out at that point, and we moved on. What a lot of people, like I said, don't realize is, you know, this is what we do for a living. So, you know, me being a 2005 and a 2007 gold medalist was far more lucrative than me to be a gold medalist and then a silver medalist. And so, you know, if they truly couldn't decide who it was, to spend that amount of time to say one person had to win and one had to lose, and then the following year, I think, like you said, it goes to media and press and things like that. They had to declare one winner, but the following year, they're like, oh, they can declare 2 silvers. That's not a big deal. We can only have 1 gold medalist. And so that's kind of like what always kind of haunts me about that race, per se.
But I guess being a defending champion, it's always great to give a decent account of yourself to try and defend your title. I mean, you were literally, you know, that very, very small margin away from doing that. That's
exactly.
Not many people defend a world title.
It's true. It's true. And yeah, to have that moment taken away as well is like, you know, you didn't truly defend. But I think those that saw the race and were there, you know, they said sport is all about like creating entertainment and creating opportunities. And it definitely was an entertaining experience for those who participated. Like, the thing that's cool about sport is you never know what's going to happen, from people breaking their legs and finishing. And, you know, there's all kinds of things that have happened in sport. That unpredictable part of it is what makes it worth tuning into.
And then another gold, you did get a gold medal in the relay, so another chance to be on the medal rostrum. But then, yeah, you say the next year, Beijing, you mentioned that obviously 2 joint silver medalists and you were there in 4th place. Were you sad to miss the podium in Beijing?
Yeah, Beijing was a weird race. I think that was the race where, you know, tons of people talked about, like, the gun, like, we weren't fully set, and then some people rocked back, and what happened exactly. I don't remember, like you said, when you kind of go in that tunnel vision, what exactly happened, but I just knew that it didn't feel right. And I was in the best shape of my life. And I'll still, you know, to this day, like that was the time that I feel like that was my time to shine. That was my time to PR. And once, you know, the kind of results of the race happened, the chaos ensued and it just kind of left a bitter taste to where I didn't even really want to try anymore. So I should have kind of regrouped. And I mean, it's the Olympic Games. So you kind of bomb out after that, as far as like you've used all your adrenaline, you used all your force. So you may be in still great shape the day after you win, but your body physically can't go fast anymore for a while. And so I ran some races after the season, and what, you know, looking back on that one, what I wish I would have done differently was, you know, try to regroup a little bit more mentally so that I could have probably put down like a personal best time, because I was in the best shape of my life. I actually did beat Shelly Ann Frazier at a race after that. The first race we had after the games, I won. And so that kind of was like more salt in the wound for me that, you know, wow, if I could have pulled this performance together a couple weeks ago, what could have happened, sort of thing.
What do you think your best time could have been then if you were in the shape of your life?
I definitely think I was in the 10.7s for sure. You know, my current it's going to be my forever time because I'm not running track anymore. But yeah, my PR right now is 10.88. I think I definitely was in, you know, 10.70 something shape. I don't know that I was in no 10.6s or anything coming out of here, but yeah, definitely somewhere in the 10.7s.
And did you always feel like the 100 was your event? Because I know you did obviously do a few 200s, but were you more comfortable over the 100?
For sure. I was definitely a short sprinter, short, straight to the point. What I really liked about the 200 was the curve. I always joke to people, like, if they could just make the 100-meter race on the curve, I would definitely be, you know, undefeated forever and ever. I love running the curve. I'd never retire from sport, et cetera. But, the 200 was just a little bit too far for me. And even when I was in, like I said, great shape, and I did, I ran a few 200s and I ran them well. But the thing I really loved about the 200 was the curve. And then it was like, oh my goodness, I still got 100 meters to go. Wait.
And you mentioned that the word short. Do you feel like your height ever hindered your career, or was it something that you ever had as a... Did people say to you that you were too short to be a sprinter? Was that ever a factor in your
career? Yeah, I just feel like people are not educated who think that you have to be tall to be a sprinter. And I love Shelly Ann Frazier Price and, you know, Veronica as well. She's not super tall, but Shelly Ann is smaller than both of us and has just been a rock for the women's sprints. So she's proved above and beyond that it's not about what your height is, and just because you have longer legs and you can go further, it doesn't necessarily make you faster. Everybody has unique talent and everybody needs to use their unique bodies to reach their full potential.
And then after Beijing, that kind of brings us on to your third defining moment, which was your father passing away. He was only 55, and like you said, he had leukemia for a long time. Was that, obviously losing your father is tragic anyway, but I guess he'd been ill for a while, and he did get to go to Athens, didn't he, to see you compete. So that kind of was something positive for you to share.
Yeah, so like I said, to add kind of insult to injury, in 2008, I learned after competing in the 100 right before the relay that the reason my dad didn't come to 2008 was that he was in the hospital. So he was ill, his, you know, leukemia had come out of remission, and it was just super frustrating to find out that, you know, that was the real reason that he wasn't there, because they kind of said it was like about money and he waited to the last minute. You know, it's kind of like this story. They didn't want to stress me out. And then I had like this responsibility after the games to go, you know, run a certain amount of races, and, you know, coming off of being a 2007, like there's just so many obligations related to how you earn. I wasn't done with my season yet after the game. So I couldn't rush home to that, you know, to see my father. And we weren't sure then, you know, it wasn't that he had been pronounced that he was going to pass away or anything. And so I kind of went, finished the season, then I went and I visited him, then I had to come back again, and I didn't get to spend a lot of time. And so the defining part of that for me was, you know, realizing that, you know, tomorrow's not promised. There's lots of cliches that we have in life and things that we say, but not until it hits your inner circle do you realize that, you know, it's truly not promised. And also that you need to make the most of, you know, the things that are there. And so when I think about my dad, I think about how great of a cook he was. He was an amazing cook. I've not come across anyone that, you know, can cook as well as my dad. Take random things, put them together, and make them taste just wonderful. And he would say, come get in the kitchen and do this and do that. And I didn't enjoy cooking, so I cooked with him some, but I didn't really like take in the information. There's a lot of like family kind of recipes or family ways of doing things that he had that didn't get passed down. And so it became really important to me to start to communicate with, you know, my other family members and to, you know, share a part of myself with them. And, you know, like I said, I have these 5 sisters and 2 brothers, and we're spread out all over the country. So it's hard to get us together. And my dad was the person that kind of kept us, you know, it's this time, let's all meet at this place and let's do that. And, you know, as we get older, people have, you know, spouses and they got to go to the spouse's thing, or someone doesn't have money, and there's just all these different things. And so the defining aspect of it was, you know, just really getting to understand that, you know, I am not just a track and field athlete. I am more than that, and I need to lean in. I need to, one, understand what the more than that means to me, and then lean into those things. Because if tomorrow is not promised, I don't want to spend every day, you know, running around this circle, and that be the only thing that is my legacy. And I think a lot of times, you know, that's what happens for athletes, is that they get a lot of media and they get a lot of press, and, you know, this is their job, and they don't know who they are outside of the sport. And it really prompted me to decide, you know, to spend some time learning, you know, what else am I interested in? What else can I do? What other skills do I have? And how can I become a well-rounded individual that is more than just an athlete?
Yeah, I mean, and like you said, obviously he was a big part of your life in terms of, you know, getting the family together and everything like that. And I guess watching you compete, it must have been a proud moment for him.
Yeah, no one cheered like my dad. And I always did good. He was actually there when I ran my personal best time in college and as a professional. So my professional time, he came over to Europe once and I ran my best race ever. And then there was one time in college, I remember him coming early in 2004. And I had a great race. There was a girl that I just had a hard time beating. And, you know, he was there and I was like, I'm not losing this race. So my dad was definitely a force that kind of fed energy in my direction that made me be able to reach my full potential and just do my best on those particular days.
Okay. And then obviously following year after he passed away, 2009, you went to the World Champs there and finished fifth, but it was another season's best. I mean, looking back at your results over your career, it does seem like you did bring your best to the championships. Do you feel like you were always a championship performer?
I was definitely a championship performer. I think it was one of those things where you show up and everything is on the line. I did well under pressure. I didn't, you know, I felt the pressure like everyone else, but, you know, you can cave under pressure. And I just, you know, leaned into the moment and said, like, now is not the time to fail. In front of all these people is not the time to fail. So let's bring everything you got. Let's put it all together and let's make it happen. 2009 was just tough because, like I said, there's a period where, too, someone passes away and you don't really necessarily have dealt with it. So they talk about mourning and everybody grieving differently. I kind of just was like, well, business as usual. I was already living in a different place. So it was kind of just like my dad was somewhere and I was somewhere else. And I never really like had dealt with the emotion. So I know it was May of 2009. I was actually headed to practice and I tried to call my dad. And he had already I dialed the number and then I was like, oh, wait, what am I, you know, doing? And I think that was kind of like the moment in my head where the grieving process started. And it was just a rough season. Like, I just, like, why am I here? Why am I participating in the sport? Why does any of this matter? Like, I could be dead. You know, like, there was just, like, a whole set of things that I needed to deal with. And so I wouldn't say that my performance was poor, but that was kind of the beginning of, you know, just, like, a downward spiral as it pertains to my passion for the sport, I think, as well, in addition to, I was an older athlete at that point, you know, 4 or 5, I'd been through 4 years. That's kind of a good bit. Most people retire after that. So it was really cool that I, you know, wasn't done yet. I still had another games in me and apparently 2 more Olympics. But yeah, it was just a tough year.
And then did that bleed into the next year? Because you didn't really compete that much in 2010. It was a bit more of a quieter year, and kind of 2011 as well. Was that just did you get a little bit disillusioned with the sport?
Yeah. And it's funny because, you know, we didn't talk very much about coaches, but coaches are such an important part of creating a world-class athlete. There are tons of people, I'm sure, that are faster than myself and probably even faster than Usain Bolt. But, you know, they're at home on a couch or they don't have the proper coach. They don't have someone that's telling them what they need. So as much as we are the vessels and we are the talent, we also have to be with someone who understands how we tick, what makes us tick, and, you know, cares enough about us to help us reach our full potential. And I remember her sitting down in that 2009, you know, after we competed, and she said, you don't want to be here. I can tell you don't want to be here. You know, your mind is not in this, your heart is not in it. And I don't want to coach someone who doesn't want to be here. Like, you have these obligations, but you're not obligated to do anything. And if you're unhappy, I want you to be happy. So I need you to think about what is it going to take for you to be happy. And let's work on you doing that. And, you know, I went home for the off season and I told her, I don't want to run next year. And I will always be grateful to her for, you know, giving me the space to think about that, to, you know, really understand what I wanted and to take the space to take the break. I took a huge risk too. 2009 was the end of a contract for me, so I needed to go get a new contract, and I was not planning on running the first year of that contract. So it complicated things quite a bit, but my coach saw that the person was more important than the athlete. And I think a lot of coaches don't have that skill. But it was a really important thing. And I did end up taking 2010 off to just kind of reflect and decide what I wanted to do. I did a lot of informational interviews with other people that were successful in business and all kinds of different things. And just kind of got a real understanding for, like, you know, who am I be off the track? Who am I beyond this sport? Because I know I'm more than an athlete, but I don't know what else I am.
Do you think that's something that's changing a little bit in elite sport now, is that there is more awareness of, like, the mental health of the individual, and how, you know, there is, you know, when their career ends, it is a bit of a moment. And you mentioned your coach there, like, knowing, recognizing the signs. Do you think that's something that more coaches should be doing now? And was there much of that going on back in the day when you were competing? Did you see that around you? Did you see any other coaches not picking up on those things and just pushing their athletes a bit too much?
Oh yeah, I definitely saw the push too hard, this is all we got, you know, athletes kind of being treated like a cash cow. Like, when you do good, I do good, so you need to get out there and do good, sort of thing. And, you know, I think the tide is changing. And, you know, like I said, because there's more awareness around it, athletes are doing more self-reflection to be able to speak up about what they need and, you know, giving themselves permission to take a mental break. But, you know, we still got a lot of work to do in this area, because athletes are put on these platforms and these pedestals, and, you know, there's a lot of pressure put on us day in and day out, whether you're a medalist or not, to be the best at this thing and to, you know, just put all your focus and your time and your, you know, thought process into this one thing. So you don't know who you are outside of that. And it does cause, like, severe mental breakdowns. I know quite a few that have struggled with, like, mental illness toward the end of sport or after sport. And I think a lot of it has to do with how they were treated during the time they were participating in the sport.
So you're quite grateful that the team that you had around you were pretty solid, and they were aware, looking after you more than themselves.
Exactly. I am so grateful.
And then moving on to Olympic year 2012, you were sixth in the national champs, so that means you made the relay team. How was that? Was that bittersweet to not make an individual spot?
Definitely bittersweet is the perfect way to describe it. You know, I didn't perform well, and yeah, I don't have an excuse. You know, like I said, you look back on and you're like, oh, I wish I would have done this, I would have done that. I just think I was just burnt out at that time. And taking the year off definitely took a toll on me. So a lot of people were just like, if you take the year off, you'll never be the same again. And I think that there was some of that, but there was also, like I said, just generally, you know, less passion for participating in the sport in general. So that was kind of the first thing. But then, you know, I made it as part of the relay, which I thought was kind of ironic, because there had been two relays I participated in, and, you know, they didn't go well. So I thought it was really cool that they had enough confidence in me to realize, like, I was the veteran athlete as it pertains to those that were participating, and they needed a veteran who is used to being at the games, used to the environment, to share it with those athletes. And what I was mature enough to know at that time was what happened in 2004 and 2008. And I mentioned it earlier about this idea that we didn't have very good chemistry, and that was really the thing that set us back. And so I saw it as my job as not to be the person on the track, but to be the person that made sure that we had good chemistry so that we could get on the track and actually win the race.
And I think that kind of has proved to be the case since, because that team, that unit, has kind of remained. I mean, in Rio, Tiana and Allison were still in the same team. It does feel like that the US sprint team has been a unit since those games. And obviously you ran in the heats, and then obviously in the final they broke the world record, which has, you know, been stood for years, and it was a real moment. But how was that for you? Was it always the plan for you just to run the heats, or was it still up for debate that you could have been in that final squad?
it was pretty much always the plan for me to run the heats. You know, there was some back and forth, you know, with some of the other athletes and what leg they could run. And, you know, that was the kind of, that's the reason you have alternates. So a lot of people think, oh, we just put the four fastest people on, but you've got to be able to take the baton in the correct hand. You need to, you know, be able to run the curve versus the straight. There's a lot of the kind of logistics that go into it, the tall person versus the short person. And so, yeah, I knew pretty early on that I wasn't at the top of the list, that would, you know, probably be one of the final four unless something happened. But I was okay with that. Like I said, I felt like I was there for my opportunity. I knew what my purpose was, and it was to keep that team together, keep the communication lines open so that there was no anger or bitterness, about who was going to participate.
But then I guess, obviously you got a gold medal out of it because you ran in the heat, so you are officially an Olympic champion, but at the same time you didn't get to go on the rostrum and listen to the anthem and be a world record holder. So how do you look back on that moment?
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things people bring it up all the time. Like, well, did you feel cheated? Did you feel slighted? And I was like, no. You know, initially I felt very embarrassed. I didn't want to have the Olympic gold medal because I was like, I didn't run the gold medal race. But like I said, once again, when you look back on things, you realize like I had to kind of evolve to a place where I did my part. And I know I did my part because I know, like you said, what went wrong previously. And I know what I contributed to making sure that those things didn't go wrong. And that the medal, like you said, is a little bit of everybody's job. In the same way that your coach is a gold medalist, you know, that's the person who coached you to get there. You know, all the support people that participate have done their part to earn that medal. And that, you know, I did feel like I did my part to earn it.
And I guess it is the gold medal from 2004.
Right, exactly.
That should be yours. okay, and then 2013, that was your final track season. Did you know going into it that was going to be your last year?
Yes. So I had the fortune of kind of choosing that was going to be my last year. So it was the last year of my contract. It was after an Olympic year, except my performances in general were starting to slide down. And for me, it was very much about not wanting to be remembered as like the athlete that couldn't let go and kind of tarnishing your legacy. So if I couldn't continue, you know, I probably could have competed for 3 or 4 more years, you know, trained full time and, you know, done it without a contract, earned a little bit of prize money here and there. No one really makes you get out of the sport, but I didn't feel like my time was going to be best spent if I was not going to be competing to win and if I was not going to be competitive in that realm of getting up there to compete to win. And so 2012 was kind of like the nail in the coffin where, you know, I put forth a good effort. I did not do good. That was the grand stage. You know, I'm not trying to get ready for the grand stage anymore. So it was cool to be able to have that kind of foresight or understanding and, you know, to walk into it knowing this is my last time competing at this particular place, and this is my last time at this particular place, and to be celebrated in some of those places when I shared it with the, you know, meet organizer and things like that.
But then I guess for us as fans, we saw you compete in 2013, and then literally 6 months later, you're in the Olympics in a bobsleigh. How did that happen?
Yeah, the world is crazy. So I ran into Lolo Jones in the airport. I had read an article about her having tried bobsled the previous year after 2012 and ran into her at the airport and was just talking to her about it. She's like, you should totally try it. It's a, you know, really cool sport. It was just, you know, like a sense of community and team, and the Olympic year is coming up and they'll teach you what you need. I was like, the Olympic year, like totally over my head once again, like not thinking about it at all. Was just basically thinking like, I need something else to do life after sport. I'm not really sure what I want to do yet. This could be like a fun thing to kind of keep me busy. And, you know, got into it and 6 months later was at the games.
I like how you described that as a fun thing to keep you busy. I'm not sure many people have that as their idea of fun.
Right.
So how did that happen then? I mean, did you just rock up and say, hi, I'm a sprinter. I can push this thing pretty quick.
No. So yeah. So I went online and they have what they call a combine. And I was like, oh, I know how to do these different things. And the time that I was actually able to go and participate was the last time that anyone could try to qualify. So I showed up at basically the championship where there's like small combines prior to where you can get invited to the championships. I basically got invited directly to the championships, you know, because of my sprint expertise. And, you know, it was like, well, we'll see what happens. And I literally had no days. Like I learned how to push the day before the push championship started. Just one day of practice before everyone else arrived. It was like, okay, here's what you do. You know, push it as fast as you can, jump in and just sit on this thing. It's like, okay, we'll see what happens. So yeah, it was very much a deer in headlights, had no idea what was going to happen, but just figured why not. And why not worked really well for me.
What was that first run like in an actual bobsleigh? Was it scary?
Oh, it was awful. God awful. It's pretty much like being kicked off a cliff in a washing machine.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Wow. But then you say you were competing on the World Cup. You got paired up with Alana Myers, who's one of the best drivers in the world. And you say you qualified for the Olympics. I mean, did you expect to be going to another Olympics?
I didn't. I had no idea that it was a realistic thing at all. And I think that probably the thing that helped me the most was kind of, they say ignorance is bliss, is that I had no expectation. I was just like, I'm just going to have a good time. I'm going to help as much as I can. And that 2012 team of, like you said, being there and being in a support role gave me a tool that I was definitely going to need to use in bobsled, because I was ready to be in that support role. Like, okay, whatever it is that I need to do to help you all, I'm here to do it. Like, where can I lend a hand? Where can I lift the sled? Where can I, how do I fit into this scenario? Let me put my best foot forward. And, if it's not me that's chosen, I wish you all the best, because I know I don't know very much about this. So how could I assume that I deserve a spot here? I'm going to do my best and hope that I earn a spot here. But I definitely don't think that I'm just going to be automatic, like, oh, they're going to give me a spot. So I had the right mindset, I think.
And then you get to Sochi, and it must have kind of felt a bit like a track meet, because you had Hannah Marion, the Belgian sprinter, you had Lolo Jones, you had Yana Pittman. It was all the track guys were there. What was that like?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty cool to see a sport where, you get to transition, you get to pivot into something else, and you get to use your body in a different way. So I think that's one thing that a lot of athletes struggle with is, like, you're still one of the strongest or the fastest, maybe not strongest, fastest in the world in that particular thing. But, how can I use this, physical ability I have in some other way, sort, form, or fashion? And bobsled is one of the things that you can do. So it was really cool for me to be able to find that and, to be able to use my body differently and still kind of figure out how to reach its full potential at something different.
And again, just following on from your career of fine margins, it was another close one, an Olympic silver medal again, but only 1/10 away from the gold. And how was that to kind of see that kind of be snatched away a little bit?
That was a tough loss. Really, really tough loss to, lead for three rounds, to break the, track record, I think all three rounds as well. And then to, push okay the last round. And also, like, there were some driving errors, like, to, lift your head up and, like, feeling like I gotta have it. We gotta have won this thing. And then to find out, like, nope, you slipped down into second, was a really tough thing. But I really enjoyed the journey. So once again, it was one of those things where I was like, I can't be mad about what has happened or what I've experienced, because I had no idea I would be here.
So did you know that at the time that you were I think you were the fifth person to have won a medal in the Summer and Winter Games and the first American woman to do so? Were you aware of that at the time?
No, yeah, they made me aware actually as you were going through, like, the press, media pin at the end of it. I mean, I think it's pretty cool to be the first American woman to do something. Now you go in history books, you go in, Black history books as well. And to be the first in the whole country to do something is a pretty cool thing to be able to tout.
And then your fourth defining moment is retiring from sport with a bit of, like, regret in a way. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, so for me, retiring from sport was a tough thing to do. Like I said, a lot of people struggle. You're leaving this thing, you wake up in the morning and no one is cheering for you anymore. And so it's like, well, who am I? What do I do instead? How do I, how do I go ahead with life? And not only that, but there's this kind of, like, coulda, woulda, shoulda. So I don't think anyone retires from sports having accomplished everything they want, but I'd guarantee if you ask most athletes, like, how do you want to retire? It's like standing on top of the podium after breaking the world record. And, you have all this list of, like, how perfect it's going to be. And it's just not realistic. It's not realistic. And it's the same way our careers. We didn't win every single gold medal, every single race, every single competition. There's no, like, very few undefeated people that, your whole career is undefeated. And, it comes with it, the wins and the losses and things like that. But you know, what, for me in that last season, the thing I wanted to achieve was a personal best in the 200. And so, you know, I had one, but I thought that I could run faster. And I was really trying to get myself in shape to run a better 200 than I previously did. And I, you know, I didn't get that opportunity. And so there's all these, like, kind of, like I said, coulda, woulda, shoulda things that make you feel like, oh my goodness, I missed out on this. I, you know, I have to leave this behind. But kind of defining moment for me is, like you said, once I kind of dealt with those feelings, is to realize that there are tons of things in life that are worth winning. And that's kind of where the name of my company came from, is like, you don't win, you know, perfectly every single time, but you're pursuing, the pursuit of winning is the thing that you're going after, and the journey that you're on to pursue that, you know, that win. And you know, wins can be small. It can be like, I got out of bed this morning. Like, you know, I got my workout in today. Like, that's a big win for me nowadays. So to kind of reframe my mind, after like having that feeling and that experience, was a really big turning point in the way that I'm like, oh, okay, the world's not going to end if I, you know, get knocked down some days, you know, everything is not going to go perfect. And to allow myself like some grace to be able to say, while I am, you know, done with this thing and I'm on to a next chapter, I didn't accomplish everything I wanted. What did I accomplish? Let me focus on the things that I did do and, you know, how meaningful and impactful those were.
And was it after Sochi in 2014 where you decided that was it for you as a sports person, and that was just time to kind of leave that life behind?
Yeah, I actually did a half a season in 2015 because I wasn't so sure. So I left Sochi and I was like, yeah, I'm done. And then I got home and I was like, well, I don't have anything to do. And then I was training because I had nothing else to do. I did just like, well, I'm just keep exercising. And then before I knew it, I was in decent shape. And I was like, oh, I'll come back. And then I got over there and I was like, this is not it. So, you know, that's another thing. Like, you know, I talked about being grateful to my coach, and I'm really grateful to that team, because I basically was like going through the transition actively, you know, and kind of taking advantage of my team to do that. Like, I'm like, oh, I want to be here, guys. Oh, just kidding. I don't want to be here. But I think people can relate to how hard it is to, you know, really figure out what that transition is. And they were very kind in, you know, cutting me some grace during that time period.
And then your fifth and final defining moment is attending an event and as Olympian with a bit of an identity crisis. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, so, you know, I got to the transition and, like, you're trying to figure out what you want to do, who you want to be, how you want to pursue life. And one thing I can say as an elite athlete, there are no shortage of opportunities that are available to you. But they're not all good opportunities. They're not all opportunities that are going to pour into you and really help you be your best, you know, reach your full potential. And so if you're not careful, people will take advantage of you. And so what I found myself was doing, saying yes to everything, because I was like, well, I can't, you know, figure out what I want to do at home on my couch. So I'll say yes to this podcast. I'll say yes to this, you know, event in Ohio. I'll say yes to this event here, there, because who knows who I'm going to meet? Like, there's a possibility and opportunity out there. But they were largely, you know, people that were, you know, we'll pay for your flight and your hotel, but we're not going to pay you any money. So now you pay for your, you know, parking at the airport, you know, your bills still got, you got to keep a roof over your head. So your rent, your mortgage, your lights, your whatever, all that stuff still has to be paid. And you're just running around all over town busy, but not actually doing anything to pour into yourself. And so, you know, one part of that is monetarily, but the other part of it is something that you actually care about. So there's things you can do, and then there's things you can do because they're important to you, they're impactful to others, that you have passion behind them. And so, you know, just kind of running through life and not doing anything is not super productive. You know, I was having this bit of a, like, identity crisis, and I don't know what I want to be, and, you know, one of these events is going to tell me what I want to be. And I remember being at this thing and a gentleman saying, like, oh, you know, you're Olympic athlete, so, you know, What are you going to do next year? Like, what, you know, when do you start your training again? And I was like, no, I've actually retired. And, you know, he said, well, why did you do that? Like, and I was like, because I'm done and I'm, you know, trying to figure out what I want to do next. And he's like, so are you going to coach? And I said, no, not interested in coaching. Or are you going to be a commentator? And I said, no, not interested in that either. well, are you going to be a personal trainer? And so this gentleman was projecting onto me all the things that an athlete is supposed to do life after sport. And it was like, you know, and he meant well. He didn't, you know, he was just making small talk. But it was the most offensive conversation because once, and I had had it, you know, 50 times at 50 other events as well. But it was like, you're nothing other than some sort of, you know, sports person, and that's all you'll ever be. And I realized, like, I have a finance degree that I haven't started using yet. I have a master's degree in business. I'm interested in finance. I have a real estate license. And no one ever asked an athlete, like, well, what are you interested in? You know, instead he was telling me, and as many people do, this is what you are, this is who I see you as, and this is all you can be. And it led me to thinking, like, I'm nothing other than an athlete. No one's ever going to see me as anything other than an athlete. And so therefore, now because I'm not an athlete, I'm worthless. And so a huge defining moment in my life was, you know, dealing with that, suffering through that for a while, but then also realizing that that was a complete lie. And that, I am whoever I want to be, and I tell my story. So if you come and you say, Lauryn, oh, you're going to go into coaching, right? You know, it's my responsibility to speak up instead of, you know, you projecting that on me and making me feel bad to say, no, actually, I'm interested in finance, and I have a finance degree. And what I'd really like to be able to do is help athletes organize their finances and, you know, to show people that I am more than an athlete, that I have other interests, but also that other athletes have interests. And to let my story be told through me versus you telling me what my story is.
So I guess my question now for you is, who is Lauryn Williams?
Ooh, that's a good question. Lauryn is a person that is ever evolving and trying to be her most authentic self from one day to the next. Trying to think outside of the box and to, you know, live outside of the box as well. Like, There is no one thing that I am. You know, today I am a public speaker. Like I said, I'm going to do a speaking engagement after this. I'm a podcaster. I've also been a financial planner this morning. Later, I'm going to be a gardener because I'm going to go water my grass. Like, you know, I am who I am, and I get to write that story. I get to decide about it, and, you know, I want to feel good about whatever it is that I'm choosing from one moment to the next.
Okay, well, looking back on the five defining moments that you picked, which is going to university in Miami, visiting Africa for the first time, your father passing away, retiring from sport a little bit unfulfilled, and your identity crisis that you just talked about, which one of those five would you say is the most defining in your life?
I'd say that last one. Like I said, it was a very painful time for me to not really understand who I was, what I could do, and, you know, to know if I was ever going to be able to do anything else again. And to, like I said, to feel worthless is a really terrible feeling. I'm very fortunate that I didn't think about things like taking my life, but I know that I was very sad, and I can understand where athletes get to those kind of points. And I think that that was a defining moment, was like figuring a way out of something that felt like, you know, you are nothing. You're, you know, there's no point to you other than to be running fast. And if you're not running fast, you know, to figure my way out of that lie was a huge defining moment, because now I'm writing my own story.
Cool. I just got three quick questions, which I ask everybody. Did the low points in your career affect the high points and vice versa? Were the highs affecting the lows?
Oh, for sure. I would say that one definitely does affect the other. So you're low and you choose to kind of, like I said, I implemented what I call the 24-hour pity party, where you basically, you know, get to be sad for 24 hours and then you like kick yourself in the butt and say, let's get going. So it's okay to feel those emotions, to be sad, but we're not going to stay there for weeks and eat, you know, pies and lay on the couch, and we're going to get going, get moving, and you get 24 hours.
Is there one specific moment in your career that you'd do differently?
I don't have very many regrets about, you know, my time in sport. I mean, maybe something to make those relays not go poorly. You know, maybe to have stepped up and been more of a leader when I saw things weren't going well, instead of like letting it take its kind of own natural course and knowing that that course was not a good course. So yeah, maybe that's the thing I would change.
I thought you might have said dipping a little bit better in Osaka in 2007, but
right,
just getting that little bit more. And then, is there anything any advice that you'd give to your younger self?
My younger self, I would tell my younger self to ask tons and tons of questions. There are no such thing as stupid questions. That's 100% true. Research as much as possible and, you know, to communicate with people as much as possible, because the way you learn is by having discussions with others. Gathering that information from someone else is one of the best things you can do to make sure that you're well-rounded.
And you mentioned now that you're doing your own podcast and things like that. Where can people find you now? Where can we find Lauryn Williams?
Yeah, so I'm pretty easy to find. My company is called Worth Winning. So you can type in worth-winning.com. You know, as an Olympian, you can find out more about me at lauryn-williams.com. I'm on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, all those things as well. You know, if you type in either Worth Winning or Lauryn Williams. Now, one thing is that I'm Lauryn with a Y, so L-A-U-R-Y-N, not E-N, if you're looking for me. And then the podcast, yeah, it's called Worth Listening. I'd really love it if people started listening to the podcast. It's all about people having money discussions and just telling their story so that you can not feel alone. So if you're interested in being a guest on the podcast, you can totally do that. But it's just about telling people a little bit about what you went through financially, so people realize, like, oh, I'm not the only person that had debt. I'm not the only person who, you know, gave money to a stranger and they ran off with it, or, you know, all these kind of crazy stories that we hear. People make mistakes, but they can also rebound from those mistakes, and we're not, you know, immune to whatever it is that we come up against. And we're all trying to learn and better organize our finances one day at a time. And we're doing it differently. And there's no right or wrong answer to how you do it.
And you've also written a book, which I think has the best title for someone who is working in business and who was an athlete. What's it called?
The Oval Office. Yes, because the track is an oval and that is where we had to show up every day and do our work. So yes, The Oval Office is about all things professional track and field. I wanted that to be my gift to the sport, to help people better understand how to organize themselves, treat themselves as a business, you know, understand how to choose a coach, an agent, organize their finances, branding. All those things are covered. It's kind of like all the things I wish I would have known while I was competing. So the mistakes I made, I'm sharing with you so you don't have to make them.
Okay. My final question to you is, just thinking about everything we've discussed, what does sport mean to you and how does it fit into your life?
What does sport mean to me? Sport is a way to bring people together, whether that is bringing athletes together on a team, bringing, you know, different teams together in a country, or bringing fans together on a world stage to watch those athletes compete. Sport is a really cool way to create unity in a community. And I think it's important that we get back to sport, especially in this time of a pandemic, because we need more unity right now.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for being on the podcast. I really enjoyed it, and I hope you did too.
I did. I can't wait for it to come out.
Well, that's it for another episode of the My Defining Moments podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. It was really great listening to Lauryn discuss how she transitioned from athletics to bobsleigh. Don't forget to subscribe or follow the podcast, and feel free to rate or leave a comment. The pod is available on Spotify, Google and Apple Podcasts, and also available now on YouTube and Amazon Music. So all you need to do is ask your Alexa to play My Defining Moments podcast, and there it is. You can also find me on all the socials at Chris Brown Sport if you have any questions or requests. You can also email me chris@chrisbrownsport.com, and I'll be back soon with more My Defining Moments.